Welcome to the Craig and Greg Show, presented by Maximize Leadership. Here are Craig Owens and Greg Harris.
Hey, welcome to the Craig and Greg Show. I'm Craig. This is Greg. We're really glad for you to be with us this month, but we're also very glad this month that we have a special opportunity to salute some very special people.
Well, special people are important in our lives, and hopefully people who are important to us think we're special, but that's not what we're doing today. Right. We're saluting and celebrating veterans.
Yes.
Tell me one thing that you've learned as we kind of prepared for this episode about veterans or military folks that is unique to the United States of America.
Well, the United States military is the only military force in the world where people sign up. It's not compulsory for them to step into that incredible role of guarding our freedoms.
That's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
I wonder for leaders, you know, if we weren't paid, would we want to be servant leaders? Or is it partly because it's the right thing to do? Mm. And that's our challenge as leaders, is willing to serve. You know, your book, The Servant Leadership Piece, is all about that. It's just be a shepherd. And I think, obviously, the military, the veterans aren't shepherds, but they are guardians. Yes. And I love that word for them. So,
yeah.
Do you have any family members that have served in the military? Mm-hmm. Maybe do a shout out and maybe share what you've learned, you know, legally, you know, that sure. You dare share. Because, you know, thousands and thousands of people are listening to us today.
Right. Yeah. Well, my favorite veteran that I'll give a shout out to is my dad, who served in the Korean War.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of the things that I learned about his involvement is that he wasn't on the front line where the bullets were flying, but how many jobs there are to make the whole thing work. I mean, a lot of times when we think about military, we think about the heat of the battle, but you forget about all of the things that go on to even make it possible for those guys to be where they are.
Mm-hmm.
And there is no dispensable member. There's not one function in that whole organization that you could say, oh, well, this part, you know, we could kind of do away with this.
Mm-hmm.
So listen, veterans, I don't care where you served or how long you served or what position that you were in. We do salute you, and we're so grateful for your service to be able to do that. And I think that I love that question that you asked at the beginning. How many leaders would step into a position and take on maybe some pretty rough assignments,
right,
some thankless assignments at times, if they weren't getting paid for it or they weren't getting some kind mm-hmm. of recognition for it?
I think some leaders, if you know the outcome, it's easier to serve.
Mm-hmm.
In the military, you don't necessarily know the outcome. You don't know who's coming back with you.
Right.
You don't know what it's going to cost you.
Right.
And yet they still go in, and for the love of country, and again, you know, one of my favorite holidays is 4th of July, Memorial Day. I just love those. They're so patriotic. And I'm not saying the government's awesome. I'm just saying our country's awesome. Where we've been, and I think where we can be with good leadership. Speak about volunteerism, you know, because that's really what they're doing, right? They're exchanging some privilege and certainly their freedom to serve and protect all of us or protect another assignment.
No.
But what about volunteerism that kind of intrigues you for leaders?
I think that's whenever I've interviewed somebody for a job or placing them in a position somewhere, I love when I'm looking at their resume and I see that they have been involved with a volunteer organization.
Mm.
Because if you can lead volunteers, you know, when one of the tools that you don't have in your toolbox is to say to somebody, you're fired. When you can't do that,
right?
That tells me a lot about your ability to be able to lead. When you have to say, you know, this person is really difficult, that I'm having a hard time getting them to mesh with the rest of the team, but I don't have the option to fire them, so How can I make this thing work? And that speaks a lot to me, that the people can lead in that kind of environment.
I think one of those trigger differences between, you have a job, you get paid, there's expectations, mm-hmm. performance, outcome, work together, blah, blah, blah. Or you're volunteering. There's no compensation. So the cause has to be so much bigger than the compensation.
Yes.
And I think for leaders, as we serve people and we find others mm-hmm. to serve, we have to look at the cause. You know, what's the greater good of why we're in business, whether it's a church, a nonprofit, education, a business, whatever it is. I love that cause weighs more than compensation. And it's not a bad thing to ask of leaders as you learn about the heart.
Yes.
It's not a pocketbook, right?
Right. Well, I think that even if somebody, money is obviously a motivator for some people. But if your only attachment to an organization is just, I got to go there and I look at the clock and I clock in and I clock out and I do my, here's my job description, mm-hmm. I do my job when I'm there. And then at the end of the week, I get a paycheck. After a while, then you say, well, is there somewhere that the job description's not as intense or the pay is a little bit better? But I think that if you say, hey, what I know about my organization, I go there to work, but I know that my company is making an impact, making a difference somewhere. I loved my daughter Samantha when she began working at her new company. They took one day and they said, hey, we're going to go out and we're going to do a beach cleanup. And they were along the Lake Michigan shoreline just picking up the trash and that sort of thing. I think that people have a greater allegiance to the company when they say, hey, you know what? The reason why we work hard is so that we want this company to be profitable enough that they can give us the time to say, hey, we want you to be able to volunteer your time to be able to serve someplace else.
I would suspect military and saluting the veterans is our theme. But when you're talking leadership, there is something to be said for the greater good, bigger cause, something that's bigger than myself, making a difference versus I do this function and we make a gadget.
Right.
And we sell 1,000 gadgets a week to who we don't really know,
right?
But the greater good, the making the difference, the cause part, I want to be a part of something. Speak to that as a leader as we recruit and develop others.
Yeah, well, I think that that's the bigger picture. Yeah. If it gets kind of small, it's a very small, you know, we've talked a lot about the abundance and the scarcity. I think it really is a scarcity mindset when you're just going like this. You're just looking at the, okay, how can we make more of those gadgets at the same cost or less cost so that while we were improving the bottom line? And if that's all that you're doing for people, there's not really a sacrifice that's there.
No.
If you say, hey, listen, we're working hard and if you're willing to sacrifice some things, look what we're going to be able to do. You know, I think of that organization like Tom's Shoes.
Yeah.
You know, if you buy a pair of shoes, we're going to take another pair of shoes and we're going to donate it to somebody who can't afford to buy a pair of shoes.
I would suggest that sort of missional company is similar to what the veterans, when they signed up to say, I'm going to serve my country.
Yes.
They could have been the first person in their family. It could have been the seventh. So there's a lineage or a legacy of it all. But you're going to say to someone with a shoe, someone else can get shoes. This case here, we enjoy freedom in America. Other countries may enjoy that as well, and that might be their assignment. So we're actually bringing the freedom story on the road when the military serves or they help protect another country or et cetera. I think the part that is fascinating about leadership and the military, for leadership, we measure it by outcomes. Oh, he's really good. She's an outstanding leader because they grew or they got the scalability and did something. Whereas in military, the assignments in some wars have been muddy, cloudy. What was the assignment anyway? But I think for most veterans, that's a fascinating lesson for us leaders. Mm-hmm. They didn't always get control of what was the outcome. They still served.
Yep.
They still gave everything they had. They actually sacrificed and served.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And some of them gave like that line as the last full measure of devotion.
Yeah.
For that cause.
I think the one thing that I would just throw back to you, Craig, and you can share with the audience, what is it about the veterans that leaders could learn from? What are those some of those qualities that make it really unique to be a veteran that we're saluting and we love them? But what would be that some of those qualities you'd say, hey, leadership, follow what the veterans do?
Well, I'll tell you one of the things that I really like about them, but let me put this plug in first before I say that.
Oh, boy.
If you are an employer, or if you run a nonprofit and you're looking for volunteers, I would highly, highly recommend that you go out and recruit some people who have retired from the military. because here's what I love, and here's the lessons that I've learned from the military guys that I think of one right now. Shout out to you, Dan. I love having him around me. These guys know chain of command.
Yeah.
Okay. There is respect for everybody in the organization, whether they're lateral to them, below them, above them. There is respect because all of them have made the same commitment.
Yes.
And they know that. But I also love the ability to not only follow, like, here's what we're doing, but the innovation. Like, when I hear some of these guys talk about, like, you know, a vehicle broke down or something went haywire, and here's what we came up with to fix it or to remedy the situation, their ability to think out, they're not just like mind-numbed robots, and they just, I need somebody to tell me what to do.
Yeah.
They can follow the directives of what somebody gives them to do, but they're also that ability to think outside of that box. And so I've learned so many lessons, and I love having the retired military guys on my teams wherever I can possibly put them.
Mm-hmm. What are some of the things that you've noticed? I've been around folks that served in the military, which I just ultimately respect. Mm-hmm. And there's all different ones. You know, Coast Guard is one. Yep. There's plenty. So Marines and Army and Navy and Air Force. But when you think about what they give up, what is it that you'd say from a leadership you want around you, like you said, Dan, hi Dan, or others that we all know? So what would you say that is a benefit to the org or the team?
I think it's the balance. I think that they understand, you know, I'm not going to be foolish about my sacrifice.
Yeah.
I'm going to be smart about it, but and that ability to put the needs of somebody else and my own needs. Mm. Like, I can't go, if I expend everything here, then, you know, and I've burned myself out, then I can't be of help to anybody else.
Right.
And so I think they're really kind of their big picture grasp of things. And again, that's a, and I'm sorry to say that, you know, it's a misnomer with a lot of people that, you know, they think that it's only uneducated people, well, you can't get a job anywhere else, so I'm going to go into the military.
Or, oh, no, no.
You know, and that has never been my experience with any of currently serving military or retired that I've been around. It's not like they didn't have any other options. But I know how many of those guys have said, my life would have gotten really off track had I not gotten into the military and learned some good habits and discipline that have helped keep me on track.
So you shout out to Dan. I'm going to shout out to my buddy Brian. So Brian actually wasn't a person who was down and out and didn't have options. He went to Army, played football, full ride scholarship, played well, graduated, went to Stephen Ross Business School at University of Michigan, became a chemical engineer. So he's not, you know, a person who needed a free this or, you know, a handout. He earned it all, and literally he earned it all. And he's lost some good friends from serving.
Yep.
And there's something about that as leaders that we don't really know the loss or the cost for veterans when they've served and they've lost a buddy or this is a sad situation comes out, or even in military battle they've lost. So it's tough to put that somewhere. And I think what I love about saluting veterans and kind of tying it to leadership, it's we're defending country values or we're defending company values. Mm-hmm. And I like that challenge for us in leadership, is it's how do we defend the values of our company and still embrace all the walks of life that make it beautiful?
Yes. Yep.
That's not easy.
Well, you've got a quote that I'll let you share this to kind of wrap us up. I like this quote that I think that really fits in with that idea of that we're defending something, and it's not just because it's a job description. It really is, it's much more intrinsic than that.
So as we wrap up, so a true hero, you veterans are true heroes, isn't measured by the size or their position. Like, I'm a big guy, or I can shoot really well as, you know, she's a lady, or whatever the skills are. Really, it's rather about the strength of their heart.
Yes.
Because there's going to be adversity. I mean, we're going into the military, right? The veterans. It's the same thing in leadership. You're going into a competitive environment. Another company wants a share of what you have. And you have to kind of come together as a team, but it's the size of their heart versus a position or a title. And I know there's titles in military. I know there's titles in corporate America. But overall, Craig, I think the size of the heart, and that's what you're speaking about for you with Dan or others or Dad, Brian or whoever else I wish to share in the video here. But I think that's really the part is our heart. And that gets back to servant leadership.
Yes. Yep. So listen, leaders, I would tell you, make sure that your organization isn't just about just getting the job done. Find some ways that you can invest in your people, that you can unleash them to invest in the community. Understand, like I love this quote that Greg just shared with us, get to the heart. What is the people on your team, what's their heartbeat really about? And unleash them to be able to be involved in those things, or get behind them to be able to do those. And then let's keep on saluting our veterans. You don't have to wait until November 11th on Veterans Day to tell a veteran how much you appreciate them. Anytime you see them, tell them thank you for your service. And let's remember, leaders, no matter where we are, we're always serving. If we're not serving, our leadership is just a title only. There's no heart behind it, and it's not going to be very effective. So lead, serve from the heart, and not just from the head. We want to be around to invest in you as well. Make sure that you reach out to us. You can find us on Twitter at Maximize Podcast. You can also check out our website. We've got a lot of resources there, maximizeleadership.com. And we love when you give us some feedback and when you give us some topics that you'd like us to talk about. We'll be happy to engage on those ideas as well. So be in touch. We'll be in touch with you real soon with some great content. See ya.
Get in touch with Craig and Greg through Twitter at Maximize Podcast or at MaximizeLeadership.com. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss any episodes of The Craig and Greg Show.